Good evening, everyone. Glad to be with you this evening. It's been a tumultuous week. A lot of different things have gone on, a lot of victory, a lot of glory and praise and worship and all of that good stuff headed up to heaven. God smiled down on us this week, and going into the weekend, God is continuing to smile. So let's give God all the glory and all the praise, and let's continue on, and I'll pray ourselves in. Heavenly Father, we come before you in praise and worship today, Lord. Oh, just bless this message, Heavenly Father. This is something you've anointed me to talk about, Heavenly Father. We've been going on and on and on about this issue of spiritual warfare, Heavenly Father, inside the pulpit. Now, on these glorious words that will come from my lips, Heavenly Father, I ask that you give me discernment, wisdom, and create transformation in the body, Heavenly Father, your body, your temple, your children, your people, Heavenly Father. In the name of Jesus, I pray. And all God's people said, amen.
Amen.
All right. Today's message is going to be on imposters in the pulpit. And again, as you know me by now, I go from the Old Testament to the New Testament, and I keep them bridged. And generally, going forward, I will use scriptures out of the New King James Version. I think for me, as a 21st century pastor, I want the most authentic illustration of God's holy word. And for me personally, I don't know about any other pastors out there, but me personally, I like the King James Version and the New King James Version. And every once in a while, I'll throw in a little bit of NIV, right? A little New International Version, right? Are you really anointed? Or shall I say, this message is called Impostors in the Pulpit. Again, this message is called Impostors in the Pulpit. This is a message that is needed today as it has ever been needed in the history of the Christian church. So I ask you, are you really anointed with the Holy Spirit? Called and chosen by God to really preach the gospel of Jesus Christ? Or are you impersonating a real pastor and church overseer? You know, God is amazing. Yet here again, God awakened me this morning to write this message from the sanctuary of heaven. Ultimately, when God places his revelation down in my spirit, it's like I can't think of anything else until the revelation becomes conscious and cognitive and is tangibly revealed outwardly in some type of written form. At the same token, I feel like God's hand is controlling the writing hand he blessed me with, as if he is physically writing my sermons himself. Oh, but by the grace of Jesus Christ, I have been given this opportunity to share with the world what saith the Lord. However, before I get started, let me give you the evangelical, theological definition of what a real pastor or preacher is. Now, you know, I don't care how many television programs you watch. I don't care how many concerts you go to. I don't care how many entertainers you've been blessed to be an audience for. I'm going to tell you what the evangelical, theological definition of what a real pastor or preacher is, and I quote, in the New Testament, a preacher is a person who has the inner call from the Holy Spirit and the external call from the church and has been duly set apart to proclaim the gospel. The preacher's task is to speak as a personal witness to God's revelation, a personal witness. Not my father's witness, not my grandfather's witness, not the witness of my brother at church, but God's personal witness and revelation. Interpreting it, explaining it, and applying it to the needs of the people. Again, the preacher's task is to speak as a personal witness to God's revelation, interpreting it, explaining it, and applying it to the needs of the people. The preacher is one who tells forth the message which has been received from God. Again, that's personal revelation. Not you sitting behind the computer and looking for someone else's sermon to preach. It's you and God in a heavenly conversation, and God is downloading into your spirit His Holy Spirit to give His people what saith His word. Amen?
Amen.
In one of Yale lectures on preaching, one lecturer said, and that's Yale University, one of their lecturers on preaching, stated, every living preacher must receive his communication directly from God, and the constant purpose of his life must be to receive it uncorrupted and to deliver it without addition or subtraction. That is quoted again out of Walter Elwell's Evangelical Dictionary of Theology. They say imitation is the best form of flattery. Or is it? The overseer, senior pastor. Now let's go to 1 Timothy 3, 2 through 7. And you know, again, this is one of those times where I'm going to transfer from the New King James Version and give you a little something out of the NIV. And this particular scripture in 1 Timothy 3, 2 through 7 is out of the NIV, and it states, now the overseer is to be above reproach, faithful to his wife, temperate, self-controlled, respectable, hospitable, able to teach, not given to drunkenness, not violent but gentle, not quarrelsome, not a lover of money. He must manage his own family well and see that his children obey him, and he must do so in a manner worthy of full respect. If anyone does not know how to manage his own family, how can he take care of God's church? He must not be a recent convert, or he may become conceited and fall under the same judgment as the devil. He must also have a good reputation with outsiders so that he will not fall into disgrace and into the devil's trap. Again, that's the NIV. However, I also like the New King James Version, and under this particular area, in 1 Timothy 3, 2 through 7, the New King James Version states it like this. A bishop then must be blameless, the husband of one wife, temperate, sober-minded, of good behavior, hospitable, able to teach, not given to wine, not violent, not greedy for money, but gentle, not quarrelsome, not covetous, one who rules his own house well, having his children in submission with all reverence. For if a man does not know how to rule his own house, how will he take care of the church of God? Not a novice, lest being puffed up with pride, he fall into the same condemnation as the devil. Again, that's 1 Timothy 3, 2 through 7. Are we supposed to be like Jesus Christ? Imitation. Or are we supposed to be like the acts of men? Imitation. Do large congregations, big churches, or small churches mean that the person standing in the pulpit is anointed, called, and chosen by God to be an overseer? Or is the person chosen to preach and given the title of pastor by the politics of ungodly men in an unhealthy church? On the other hand, just as anybody isn't supposed to preach or carry the holy title of pastor, it is really a holy spiritual position and not simply a job of vocation. Real pastors and preachers should have a spirit of holiness about them, where ushering in the revelation from God is so obvious, therefore one can feel God's presence beaming from the pulpit. God's word says in Hebrews 12:14, follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. The NIV says it like this in part, and to be holy. Then in 1 Peter 1:16 it states, because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy. The Old Testament priests and pastors were most certainly holy. Noah was called a preacher of righteousness. In the New Testament, the Apostle Paul was called the holiest of the holy apostles. And right behind Paul was the holy apostle Peter. When the Holy Spirit is present, you can feel the message when it's real, opposed to just hearing lip service on a stage that tickles your ears. The Holy Spirit will also show those in the congregation without blinders on when a man is lying, when he says, God told me, or God showed me. It's a red herring. Well, Pastor Carter, what's a red herring? What is a red herring? According to Wikipedia, red herring is a figurative expression referring to a logical fallacy in which a clue or piece of information is or is intended to be misleading or distracting from the actual question. Technically, it is very easy to see imposters in the pulpit. Those who are in this world but are not of this world are influenced by the Holy Spirit. Amen. Right? Secular, out of the spirit entertainers can be seen a mile away. It's like the circus is coming to town and the church advertising preceded its arrival. How does that slogan go? The circus is coming to town. The circus is coming to town. I can profess that this is true from experience, because many times after visiting certain churches, I felt like I was watching circus clowns and puppet masters saying, the show must go on. I can completely understand how some of God's people get exploited by imposters in the pulpit. In fact, when talking to the Corinthians, the Apostle Paul said in 2 Corinthians 11:20-21, in fact, you even put up with anyone who enslaves you or exploits you or takes advantage of you or pushes himself forward or slaps you in the face. To my shame, I admit that we were too weak for that. You know, I laugh as I write this because the imposters in the pulpit's game is such a racket. And God has given us ample warning to beware. As God's children, we are not supposed to just sit in the pews in a trance.
Preach, Pastor.
Basically, this is not being a good steward of what God gives us in the body of our spiritual lives in God's temple. Amen? I mean, to me, this issue reminds me of the great fish stories that these imposters tell. You know, how that great fish they had on the line got away. And then to keep you further on the fabricated line, they say, trust me, this is a true story. Technically, when a story is true, you don't have to qualify it as a convincing measure at all. The Holy Spirit will move the congregation in such a way that the truth is automatically received through the Holy Spirit hotline. You never have to convince anyone about reality. It is what it is, real. We as humans are engineered and designed by God to relate to reality physically and spiritually. Then on the other hand, imposters in the pulpit remind me of those guys who buy inexpensive cars and place a whole lot of noise-making gadgets on them to then hit the accelerator, making it appear that they are going fast, but instead are really going slow. All they are doing is disturbing the neighborhood and making a whole lot of noise. At the same token, this is a very serious issue concerning the Christian church, especially the 21st century church as we go forward. I have been in the Christian ministry for more than 21 plus years in one capacity or another. And at this point, I am simply tired of seeing families hurt and damaged by these imposters in the pulpit. And furthermore, I'm tired of seeing marriages go down because of false preaching and unqualified teaching by church charlatans. Church family out there, can you feel me? Do you understand what I'm talking about? Have you ever been hurt by a church? Do you have a family member that has ever been hurt by a church? Do you have any friends or relatives who whose divorce was caused by the church? Raise your hand. Now stay with me here. On a more humorous note, I still have to laugh because imposters in the pulpit are incredulous and go as far as to preach about their false testimonies in order to fool people. I heard one famous Christian musician call it stacking testimonies. At any rate, these preaching imposters will say something to the effect concerning their great trial or trials that's supposed to be relative to the congregation simply as a blanket statement. Trust me, I've been there. I know what it's like to suffer. God brought me through the valley. But then they don't give any deep detail or specific elements that are real of those supposed trials and tribulations of suffering. So you're supposed to just on GP believe what they say, right? You see, they have to keep it basic so their cover isn't blown. There is a philosophy out there that says, keep it simple, stupid. If they say too much, then people can figure them out. So they say as little as possible about the alleged suffered adversity trial or walk through the valley of dry bones. You know, when I hear these preaching imposters, right away the Holy Spirit nudges me to ask the questions to myself concerning them by, why are you trustworthy? Yeah. Where have you been? And how have you suffered? Where are the details of this valley you were in? Do you have any healed wounds? Any battle scars? You know, talk to me about that. Talk to me about real trials and tribulations. Talk to me about how you made it over by the skin of your teeth. Show me how God covered you in the wilderness, in the valley, in the desert. Talk to me about that. Or going up the rough side of the mountain. Not the mountain where you got ropes and steps to climb up. Right? Talk to me about climbing up the rough side of the mountain, slipping, clawing, getting up there. Talk to me about that.
Yes, you're right.
As a matter of fact, many people who have really suffered through great trials and tribulations know how someone is real or not. There is an automatic spiritual connection that joins similar testimonies like neurons in the brain. Imposters in the pulpit can't manufacture and or create that spiritual connection. So they come across as cold, false, stoic, plastic, and shallow. Then you have those imposters in the pulpit who grew up with both parents as an intact family with silver spoons on the table. Now, don't get me wrong. There is nothing wrong with having both parents together in the home. Families should be made up of a father and a mother. However, for some reason, the imposters in the pulpit, who was never anointed, called, or chosen by God to go into the ministry of Jesus Christ, all of a sudden labels himself a pastor. I'm a pastor. Right? For the most part, the imposter in the pulpit has never missed a meal due to poverty or scarcity. They have never broken a bone or stepped on a nail, nor have they ever really been sick enough to spend days in a hospital or had to physically fight with their fists to defend their life or survival. You know, we're talking about real survival. Or have they ever been so broken down that they had to call on the name of Jesus for help? Oh, God! Get me out of here. Help me, Lord. Get me out of here. But yet, they stand on a stage and preach about being a survivor and how the Lord healed them. The devil is a liar. It is true, the Lord is a great healer, but the imposters in the pulpit don't know anything about it. How can you know how God heals if you have never been sick in that area? Luke 4:23 states, "And he said unto them, Ye will surely say unto me this proverb, Physician, heal thyself. Whatsoever we have heard done in Capernaum, do also here in thy country." You better believe that there is a reason why God allowed suffering as a main characteristic of following Jesus Christ and a prerequisite for real pastoral leadership over people who enter the Christian church. Obviously, Jesus suffered the most and he set the greatest example for the world. However, he also commissioned Saul of Tarsus, the Apostle Paul, the second greatest preacher in the New Testament, when he said in Acts 9:16, "I will show him how much he must suffer for my name." Here Jesus made suffering a prerequisite to preach his gospel in a major way with no room for fiction, fairy tales, fish stories, or embellishments. Yes. Let me go off the record here for a minute and say that many women qualify a real man by the fact that he has accumulated some war wounds and scars, and that he has been around the block in real time, right? They feel confident in the relationship that he can handle some stuff and that he can take a licking and keep on ticking. He doesn't put his tail between his legs and hide behind the woman when the going gets rough. He is tough enough to stand, right? He is tough enough to stand. And I don't necessarily mean per se physically, but tough enough spiritually to stand. What's on the inside? What kind of stuff is on the inside? When you squeeze it, what comes out? Right? Remember, in Romans 5:3-5, it states in part, "Not only so, but we also rejoice in our suffering because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope." So now, ask yourself the questions. If the imposters in the pulpit never really suffered anything, how much perseverance do they have? How much real hope do they have? And how much real character do they possess? At this point, one could easily ascertain that once the going gets rough, the imposters in the pulpit get going. Jesus Christ made sure the Apostle Paul set a new example for real pastors and preachers to follow and understand in 2 Corinthians 11:23-29, which states in part, "I am more. I have worked much harder, been in prison more frequently, been flogged more severely, and been exposed to death again and again. 5 times. I received from the Jews the 40 lashes minus one. 3 times I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. 3 times I was shipwrecked. I spent a night and a day in the open sea. I have been constantly on the move. I have been in danger from rivers, in danger from bandits, in danger from my own countrymen, in danger from Gentiles, in danger in the city, in danger in the country, in danger at sea, and in danger from false brothers. I have labored and toiled and have often gone without sleep. I have known hunger and thirst and have often gone without food. I have been cold and naked. Besides everything else, I face daily the pressure of my concerns for all the churches. With that being said, imposters in the pulpit who aren't really anointed or chosen by God to preach, who are standing on a stage talking, are doing exactly that, just talking. In the real world, they are called talking heads, falsely claiming God has spoken to them. How does that saying go in the church? Fake it until you make it.
Yeah.
I'm laughing again here because the Lord reminded me of a former visitation to a church back in 1999 that was hosting a so-called traveling prophet. As my ex-wife and I were sitting in the middle of the sanctuary, this man looked over the sanctuary for someone to prophesy about. Lo and behold, he picked me. When he came over to me, he asked me what my profession was. When I told him that I was a professional basketball player, he prophesied that I would be in the middle of two important contracts sometime soon. So that means, you know, let's say this was summer of 1999. I can't remember the exact season. Sometime soon would mean somewhere shortly after summer, before winter, definitely before the year ended, right? A few seconds later, he said some other words and then turned away. At that time, I actually had a smirk on my face because this guy's spirit just didn't seem real. The fact of the matter is that my spiritual gift of discernment and wisdom picked up on his false spirit as he approached us, and it gave me internal spiritual and mental confirmation. The fact of the matter is that I have never been in between two important contracts at the same time during my whole pro basketball career. Right? In fact, trying to get the best single contract had always been through intense negotiations over one contract. Now, I've had various contracts, and each one of them only concerned itself one, right? So this false prophet's prophecy was not real, and it didn't come from God, because what he had prophesied didn't come to pass in real time. Prophetic utterances are supposed to come to pass at some point in time because God himself delivered them. Remember, God cannot and does not lie.
Amen.
I remember when I was at another church and they had invited a false prophet in to speak to the congregation. This is another funny situation because this particular guy was straight out of the circus in real time. So in the interim, this guy chose a guy from the congregation who had back problems and told him that his back is healed. Unfortunately, this guy's back never healed, and he had to eventually contemplate back surgery anyway. Again, what this false prophet prophesied never came true. So his words were not the words from God. Technically, this was just another circus act trying to deceive people in the Christian church. The deception in God's house. Remember, God doesn't lie. His holy word is clear in Numbers 23:19, which states, God is not a man that he should lie, neither the son of man that he should repent. Hath he said, and shall he not do it? Or hath he spoken, and shall he not make it good? So then, over into Matthew 24:11 in the New Testament, it states, and many false prophets will appear and deceive many people. According to the Evangelical Dictionary of Theology, the definition of a prophet is this: the one who speaks before in the sense of proclaim, or the one who speaks for, i.e. in the name of God. He is under divine constraint. It is God who invites, summons, and impels him. By inspiration, God speaks to the Nabi, who has to transmit exactly what he receives.
Yes.
Again, that's Walter Elwell's Evangelical Dictionary of Theology. This is really a spiritual matter through my gifts of discernment and wisdom that God has commissioned me to tackle. You know, there are some preachers out there that like to play it safe. But, you know, my assignment is not safe play. My assignment is to preach the Word of God in its entirety. Those who can handle it, that's great. Let's ride this train together into victory. On the other hand, those in the congregation should not just go with the flow and wear Christian blinders. More importantly, if they really took the time to care, their spiritual health is on the line. Real life does matter. Amen? Real life does matter. Furthermore, caring congregants who are skeptical of their so-called pastors should protest their church leadership to hire real pastors and preachers who are chosen by God and not chosen by the wiles of the devil, i.e. the craft.